And suddenly I'm not afraid, 'cause you speak and freedom reigns. There is hope, and every single word you say,
he can move mountains.
Keep me in the valley.
Come on, say it. Hide me from the rain. That's it. My God is awesome. Come on. Heals me when I'm broken. Strength where I've been weakened. Forever he'll reign. Come on, you got it. My God is awesome. Come on, say, he can move mountains.
He can move mountains.
Keep me in the valley.
Keep me in the valley.
Hide me from the rain.
Has
he ever covered you? Come on, my God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Heals me when I'm broken.
Heals me when I'm broken.
Strength where I've been weakened. Forever he'll reign. One word, come on, everybody. Somebody lift your voice.
Awesome.
If you know he's been good, say it.
Awesome.
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 Say, my God.
My God is awesome.
Come on, if you know he's been good, then you testify.
Awesome.
Somebody ought to lift your voice.
Awesome.
He's awesome.
Awesome.
Come on. My God.
My God.
Verse 2. Savior of the whole world.
Giver of salvation.
By his stripes, I'm healed. Yeah, my God is awesome. Listen, today I am forgiven. His grace is why I'm living. Somebody ought to praise his holy name. Come on, you say, my God. Come on, awesome.
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 Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Glad you're here tonight. Thank you for coming. Welcome. Pastor asked me to go ahead and open service tonight, so that's what I'm doing out here. Welcome. Thanks for coming once again. If you'd all go ahead and stand, I want to read just a quick verse, and then we'll pray, and then we'll get into worship. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, it says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to Him, and He will make your paths straight." Have you ever had a car that the alignment was off, and you're driving down the road, and it just keeps pulling you one way, and you're trying everything you can to pull it back the other way? Life can be like that without the Lord in our lives, right? But when we trust in the Lord with all of our heart, and we lean not on our own understandings, when we lean not on the news of everything we see in social media and in the media, when we lean not on, you know, everything the world tells us, but we trust in the Lord, He will make your paths straight. He will realign your alignment, and He will make your path straight. So tonight, I want to encourage you, lean on the Lord tonight. Trust in Him tonight. Let Him guide you and point you and realign your spiritual walk. So if you have any prayers tonight that you want to lift up to the Lord, would you let us know by lifting up your hand? We're going to pray for you, and then we're going to just get into worship with the Lord. God, we thank You for everything You do for us. God, I thank You, Lord, that when we can turn to You, God, You will realign our alignment. God, You will make our path straight once again, Lord. And God, You will make it easy for us, God, to where we're not just veering off one way or the other, but God, You're making our paths straight with You, God. I pray, Lord, that as we begin this service tonight, God, that You would, Your presence would come, Holy Spirit, and You would just have Your way tonight, Jesus. God, I thank You for all the hands that were lifted tonight, God. I thank You that You see all of our hands. God, I thank You that You see all of our needs, Lord. God, I pray, Lord, that You would come in the name of Jesus and meet all of our needs tonight, God. Those who are sick, those who are struggling with the coronavirus, God. God, those who are struggling with finances, Lord. Those who are struggling with finding jobs during this time, God. Those who are just struggling with whatever it may be, Lord. I thank You that You see us from heaven and that You will come and meet our needs tonight. Lord, we give this service over to You, God. We give our needs over to You. Lord, come and make our path straight tonight, Lord. God, we give You all the praise and all the glory in Your precious name. And everybody said, amen.
Pastor, I enjoyed the message that the Spirit led you to speak this morning. I know that, I remember you said that you felt just not 100% about it, but whatever the Spirit wanted you to say, I believe you said. And tying together being vaccinated from the virus with being covered by the blood, amen. Wouldn't it be awesome if the Spirit led Dr. Anthony Fauci to give that message to the world? What a message, amen. This opening song tonight, church, is an old hymn, "Jesus, Hold My Hand." Let's worship this morning. Let's worship this evening, church.
As I travel through this pilgrim land, there is a friend who walks with me, leads me safely through the sinking sand. It is the Christ of Calvary. This would be my prayer, dear Lord, each day to help me do the best I can. For I need Thy light to guide me day and night. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand.
Some praise tonight, church. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, yes. Amen. As we mentioned this morning, we know what the word says about two or three gathered together in his name, he'd be in the midst. Even when we practiced this morning before church this morning, we were in the presence of Jehovah.
Yes.
And we were just practicing and singing unto him, amen. Not caring how we sounded, nothing like that. Lord, look at me. We were singing as unto the Lord. Let's worship as we sing this song, church. In and out of situations that tug of war at me, all day long I struggle for the answers that I need. Then I come into his presence, all my questions become clear. My. And for a sacred moment, Jesus, no doubt can interfere.
Seated if you want to be. Sometimes I pay attention to things that details. The past few weeks, tongues and interpretation have come forth in the body here, and I heard something over and over. We heard it tonight. Talking about the path that He has prepared. You have not been left without preparedness. You are His children. And you are not out of His vision nor out from under His care. If we follow Him, we may get uncomfortable, but we will never be left alone. And He will never lead us to a place that He can't get us out of. He'll never lead us to a place where we are not safe. It all depends on our trust to follow Him. Amen? Give the Lord a good hand clap of praise and worship for Him. Been talking about the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to try and finish that tonight. I sense in my spirit a weariness with it, and so I'm going to try and finish that. It's an inexhaustible subject. You cannot fully talk about the Holy Spirit. We can't cover every detail and do justice to it. So we'll finish this area tonight, and then at some other point, if God will allow us, we'll come back and do something else with the subject. But we want to finish this part tonight. So let me start here. Rules cannot completely change the behavior or the direction of life. Some of you had rules when you were growing up. Did you find that you were able to break the rules? Sometimes there were consequences, sometimes there weren't, sometimes you got caught, and sometimes you didn't. Amen? Rules. Rules cannot change behavior completely. Laws cannot completely govern or the operation or the direction or the outcome of someone's life. Laws can't do that. Okay? We've got a lot of laws on the books, folks. We got a lot of laws on the books. We don't even know what the law actually says. Okay? Yeah. I'll be honest with you. I probably break laws every day and never know I did it. I'll be honest with you. I break some laws every day and I know exactly what I'm doing. And the little GPS tracker on the van that I drive makes me aware that they know what I'm doing as well. But laws cannot completely govern us, and laws cannot completely change our direction or the outcome of our life. And the reason I say that, if the law could do that, we didn't need Jesus. That's the difference between the Old Covenant and the New. That's the difference between the Old Testament and the New. The Old Testament was the law, the rules. And if they would have worked with the human life, then we didn't need Jesus. But God knew, even in the Old Testament, that Jesus was necessary. How do you know that? Because of the prophets. The prophets told us Jesus was coming hundreds of years before He ever did. God knew that Jesus was necessary because God knows you and I. Amen? Ezekiel in chapter 36, we discussed this just a little bit in a previous segment of this particular series, where God was talking through Ezekiel and to Ezekiel, telling them to change their lives. And just a few chapters later, He was prophesying of a time to come in the new covenant where He would do those things for us. Okay? Let me read you what he was going to do. Verse 25 of chapter 36 in Ezekiel. He said, "Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean. From all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you." Verse 26, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart of your flesh, and I will give you the heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them." Rules and laws could not accomplish what he just said. He said, "I am going to change your heart and I'm going to change your spirit in order to be able for you to be able to do what I'm asking you to do, and that is to live for me and serve me." You can't do it without him. You can't do it without a new heart and a new spirit. Amen? So he said, "I'm going to put a new heart of flesh in you." And he said, "I'm going to put a new spirit in you. And that will cause you to be able to do what I ask you to do on your own, but you couldn't do it." That's the old covenant and the new covenant. The Old Testament law, the rules, and Jesus, the price being paid over here in the new covenant, where he installs in us a new heart and a new spirit. There's a scripture in the Bible that always intrigued me, and I've heard it preached or alluded to in preaching a lot of times, where the Bible says that he will give you the desires of your heart. Have you ever heard that? Amen? What if our desires are all messed up? I think we missed his point. We missed his point. He's not going to treat us like a four-year-old that's screaming in Walmart and just give us what we want just to shut us up. What's he going to do? He is going to give you desires in your heart. What do you mean? He put a new heart in there with new desires. He will give you the desires of your heart. How many can testify here today, "God changed what I desired. I used to be this and want this and desire this, and I don't anymore." And you did that on your own? No, because he put in us a new heart with new desires and a new spirit to go along with it. And look what it says in verse 27 in Ezekiel 36. "I will put my spirit within you." I will put my spirit, not just any spirit. He said, "I'll put my spirit within you and cause you." Somebody say, "cause you." "Cause you to walk in my statutes." Rules. Rules. Everybody say rules. He says, "I'll be able to, through this new spirit, you'll be able to, and not only will you be able to, I'm going to cause you to keep the rules." Why? Because his rules are non-negotiable. The wages of sin is death, non-negotiable. God is God, and that's non-negotiable. God is God, and I'm not. That's non-negotiable. But most of the world lives today like they are their own God. And God is non-negotiable. You cannot change the rules. And since we are incapable of keeping them, Old Testament rules. He told them what the rules were, but they had trouble with it. Why? Because they had no power. But then in the New Testament, in the New Covenant, the Bible says He will install in us a new heart and a new spirit, not just any spirit, but His spirit, and we'll be able to do it. Okay? How many of you have had an easy time of it so far? Why? Because He also said there was going to be an old nature. An old nature. Your nature, my nature, our nature is to be what? Rebellious. My sister was much more rebellious than I was. She was 2 years older than I was, and she was much more rebellious than I was. I saw where it got her, and I didn't want any part of it. So instead of being rebellious, I became sneaky. It's not that I kept the rules. I got better at not getting caught. Anybody with me? Want to raise your hand? No? Okay, all right. We got one. Okay, one, two. All right, we got two people in the house of God. Rules can't do it. Law couldn't do it. But the New Testament installation of a new heart, a new spirit, could do it. Okay? And then there is a process that happens. Once we get on this side of the cross, it's found in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. Once I start, you'll be able to quote it with me, so you really don't have to turn there or not. Okay? Be not conformed to the world. That's a good idea, right? Amen? Be not conformed to the world, because if we're conformed to the world, we're not His. We're theirs. We're its. We belong to the world. We belong to the world system, the world's ideas, the world's way of doing things. Okay? Be not conformed to the way they do things. Be not conformed to that system. Be not conformed to that. Instead, it says, but be transformed. By what? By the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Okay, and I've heard a lot of preaching on that. There's the good will of God, and there's the acceptable will of God, and there's the perfect will of God. You know, God's got one will. Amen, and it's good and acceptable and perfect. Amen. He doesn't have 3 degrees. And get to heaven. Oh, well, it seems to me that you're over the in the acceptable area. Well, thank God for that. I wasn't going to the perfect area. I know that. His will for you is good and acceptable and perfect. Amen? And here's the thing. When you're following Jesus, you're going to have your work cut out for it trying to get out of His will. You need some proof for that? Go home tonight and read the entire book of Jonah. He worked hard to get out of God's will. And where did he end up? Right where God was going to send him in the first place. Amen? God knows how to get you there right on time to do what He called you to do and what He sent you here to do. I'm going to hurt you. There's no plan B. You're it. You're it. Often go back to Bill Wilson sitting on the edge of the bridge there, and his mom left him there. Said, "I'll be back," but she never came back. And a man came by and asked him just a simple question: "Are you all right?" And he said, I'm hungry. And the man fed him, paid his fees for youth camp, where he was converted to Christianity and became a tool in the hands of God. And I always ask myself, was there another man? If this one said, I'll pass, was there another one coming? And when I ask myself that, I ask myself, how many did I pass by on my road that I was supposed to ask them, are you okay? And if there is no plan B, what happened to him? What happened to the guy that I passed? That's not even in my notes. You can just take that home with you. It is the ministry of the Holy Spirit to empower us for life and service. We've been doing that all through this series. Life and service. Hold them up there, folks, for me. Life and service. Two things, life and service. That's all you're required to do is live for God and serve God. Okay? God didn't say you were supposed to change the world. He'll do that all by himself. Use you to do it, but he can do that by himself. We'll get into that in just a minute. But there's two things he wants you to do. He wants you to live for him and serve him. Okay? That's it. All right? Let's go back to Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. We've been there several times in the series. Okay? Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. This is where we get it started. This is where it happens. This is what happened. Acts chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, uttermost parts of the earth. These things... And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. I just read for you the last thing that Jesus told his closest followers before he left this planet. Okay? And here's the thing. He left the entire program of Christianity in their hands, and he left. It's a heavy weight. That's a heavy weight. He left the gospel plan in their hands, and he said, I have given you power, and you shall be my witness. And then he left. And there is no plan B. We're it. Does that scare you? Does that scare you? We're it. We're plan A through Z. We're it. But that's a heavy weight, isn't it? A lot of responsibility. He said, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And, everybody say and. Because of that power, and you shall be witnesses from where you are to the uttermost parts of the earth. It's going to start with you guys, but by the time it's done, it'll be all over the globe. Okay? Imagine you that. and saying it's going to start with you, and it's going to go all over the world. Now, the world to them ended in Rome. You know that, right? The world to them was Rome. They didn't know there was anything except outside of Rome. Okay? But they said, the uttermost parts of the earth. The earth. The old blue marble. The whole thing. Okay? Have you ever gone to an amusement park and wondered, is there anybody here I know? There are thousands and thousands of people here. I went to, you know, you go places where there's a large gathering, and of course you can't do that anymore, but go where there's a large group of people and wonder, is there anybody here that you know? And then realize that some of these people you've never met before, most of these people you've never met before, if not all of these people you've never met before, and most of the time you're probably never going to meet them again. Right? Okay? And you haven't even left the state yet. Now we're talking about the entire world. We're talking about things that kind of make your brain hurt. And he told these is going to start here with you, and by the time it's done, it's going to go throughout the whole earth. How's it going to do that? The angels are going to come and transform the sky into a moving marquee, and the gospel is going to be preached in the sky, and the angels are going to come and light here and there and give us the gospel. Nope. That wasn't the plan, was it? How was he going to do it? He said, you, as empowered believers, are going to be a witness of me. That's how he's going to do it. That's how he was going to spread it throughout the whole earth. Okay? Now, let's go on. In a criminal case, everybody that's been involved in a criminal... I feel you. Been involved in a criminal case. Don't raise your hand, but... Jury, yeah, boy, jury. You mean we're supposed to answer those letters? Let's go on. In criminal cases, there are three types of witnesses. There's an eyewitness, an expert witness, and a character witness. Okay? Eyewitness means you saw something. You saw it. You saw it, therefore you can give evidence because you saw it. Okay? Expert witness is, you are an expert in the area which the case pertains to, therefore you can give information that is relevant to the case, and your testimony can change the outcome of the case because not everybody there has your education and your experience. You're an expert witness. Okay? And then there is a character witness, which means that you know the individual in question and you know things about them that not everybody in the room is going to know about them. You know some things. Everybody say, I know. Look at the person next to you and say, I know some things. You can provide information as to the character of the person, which would be important. Well, I hope you all don't have to ever be a character witness for me. Yes, Your Honor, he's a lunatic. But a witness, everybody say a witness. A witness is a person who saw or heard something pertaining to the crime, or that they actually saw the crime take place, and you have important information about the crime or the defendant, so that your witness is called your testimony. Isn't it weird how all these terminologies transfer right into the church? He said that you would be my witness. Isn't that important? And that's going to be the vehicle by which I change the world, is your witness. That was plan A through plan Z. Plan Z. There is no plan B. If we didn't do it, it won't get done. Amen? So, let's go on. You must be, in a court case, you must be a credible witness. Okay? A credible witness is deemed to be credible if they are recognized or can be recognized as a source of reliable information about someone, some event, or a phenomenon. In other words, you must be authentic. Yeah, I'm getting in your business now, aren't I? Okay? We must be authentic. I talked about this a little bit last time we were together about the authenticity. Amen? The authenticity of a prophet is gauged how? Yeah. If they say something and they said, "Thus saith the word of God," and it does never come to pass, guess what happened? Automatically, you have to wonder, did he hear from God, did she hear from God, or did she not? Awful quiet in here. Amen? Talking about authenticity in our witness. Okay? Well, let's move on. There's a couple things you need to know about a witness. Since we are one, everybody look at your name and say, "You are one." I am one. Tell them, look at the same person and say, "I am one too." So that puts you all in the same spot and on the same level. And it doesn't matter, you know, what socioeconomic background we have, what education level we have, what the color of our skin is, what party we vote. All these other different things are immaterial because we are all in the same place. Okay? We are all in the same place. Okay, so a witness listen. A witness tells what he knows. How many of you ever watched Perry Mason? Man, it's on every day, isn't it, babe? Every day. She knows what time it is. You know why? If we're not in bed by the time Perry Mason comes on, we're late. And they get a Bible out, and they say, "Put your hand on the Bible. Do you swear to tell the truth, whole truth, nothing but truth? So help you God." Right? You ever been to court? You ever been to church? You ever been to court? What do they want you to tell them? The truth. The whole truth. And leave the rest out. In other words, leave your opinion out of it and just tell the truth. Amen. Well, boy, this is quiet. This is fun now. I thought it was going to be boring tonight, but this is fun. You tell what you know. The dictionary defines the word witness this way: one who has seen or heard something, one who furnishes evidence. Everybody say evidence. Okay? A witness is someone who can say, "I know this is the truth." Tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth. Let's look at some verses from Acts. Acts chapter 2, verses 32. You want to turn there? I'm going to be going fast because I got 10 minutes left. But let's look at some verses from Acts. Acts chapter 2, verse 32. God has raised Jesus from God has raised this Jesus to life. And listen to what he says. We are all witnesses of that fact. Okay? Acts 3, verse 15. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are all witnesses of this. Remember, this is the book of Acts now. Acts chapter 10, verse 39 to 40. We are all witnesses of everything that he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God has raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. And the first part of that verse says, we are witnesses of everything he did. Acts 13, verses 30 and 31. God raised him from the dead, and for many days he was seen by those who had traveled with him from Galilee to Jerusalem. This was after he was dead and raised from the dead. They are now witnesses to our people. Acts chapter 22, verses 14 to 15. Then he said, God, the God of our fathers, has chosen you to know his will and to see the righteous one and to hear words from his mouth. You will be his witness to all men of what you have seen and heard. I find this example striking. Well, I'm not. That's his opinion. I don't want that. Okay. If we take all these verses together, we can sum this up kind of quickly. A witness is a person who tells the truth of Jesus Christ. The disciples testified to the things that they knew were true about Jesus. Why? Because they saw it. Okay? I'm going to fast forward to the year 2021, the month of January, halfway through the month. And I'm going to ask you a question. What have you seen and what have you heard? Okay? The second point about a witness is a witness testifies of what they have experienced. Okay? 1 John chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. That which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you that your joy may be full. Okay? One reason I was never a sales rep, didn't want to be a sales rep, I was very upset when I went to Menards and got a job. And they put me in the appliance department because I had background in appliances, and they put me there. And it wasn't until the store was about to open that they told me that I would be selling appliances. I didn't want to sell appliances. Well, we'll train you how to do it. We'll tell you, we'll show you the goods at the end. I said, let me show you. I've been doing this for 30 years. Let me tell you what's going to happen. Somebody's going to come in here and I'm going to tell them which one's a good one and which one's a piece of junk. Because I've had my noggin inside all of them. And if it's a piece of junk, I'm going to be honest with you and I'm going to testify unto you. You don't want to take that one home. Okay? I never wanted to be a sales rep because you have to be able to sell whatever they give you to sell. No matter if it's good or bad, whether it's a good one or a piece of junk, you still have to be able to sell it. Okay? So it's tough to be honest when you have knowledge of the truth. Yeah. You really, if you have something that you believe in, it's not tough to sell it. Because you believe in it. You have experience. That's why they put me in that department. I had experience. They were a little disappointed when they found out how much experience I had, and I was honest enough to tell people, that's a piece of junk. No, we want you to sell it. It's not nice to sell people junk. It's not nice. And when people come in and say, well, I'm a brand name guy, I'm on a Maytag. And I tell them, sir, Maytag hasn't built a machine in 15 years. Whirlpool's building it. I've been to both factories, and one of them has boards on the windows. All right, well, let's go on. We have to have experience. Everybody say experience. We testify of our experience with Jesus Christ. We may have the script, the Roman road to salvation, the tracts to hand out, and you have all those things that can aid us and help us when we're trying to tell somebody about the truth of Christ. We have the script and all those other things. And do you know what they're looking for? Do you have any experience? My wife gets resumes from people. You ever had somebody oversell themselves? They send you a piece of paper and tell you how good they are and how much experience they have and all that other stuff. And you sit them down in the seat and you interview them and they say, oh, yes, I've done this and I've done that and I've done all these other different things. And then you put them in the seat, you hire them, you put them in the seat, and they know nothing. Why? Because they have no experience. And that's one of the things that they always ask you in the interview process. What is your experience? Well, I went to college. I know, I read that. What is your experience? Well, I worked for this, and I worked for that, and I worked for that. What did you do while you were there? That has nothing to do with what I'm trying to hire you for. So therefore, you have no experience. You see what I'm saying? Experience. We can have the Roman road, the tracks, and everything that goes with it, and try and tell somebody about Jesus. What they really want to know is, do you have any experience with Jesus? Okay? Now, everybody look at your neighbor and say this with me. There's a difference between telling and selling. There's a difference between telling and selling. One of them's your job and one of them's not. Okay? A witness is supposed to tell. The Holy Spirit will do the selling. Don't try and guilt trip somebody into Jesus. Tell them the truth. Tell them about your experience and let the Holy Spirit sell the project. When I got saved, after the little boy thing, okay? After the little boy thing, okay? Got saved when I was a little boy, backslid, made a mess of my life, came back to Jesus, teenage, okay? When I got saved, there was a singing going on at the church, okay? Now, did they come to sing to me? No. They came to sing to whoever was there, okay? But Jesus knew I'd be there. So the Holy Spirit was also there to sell the project. I didn't get convicted in my soul and want to be saved because of their songs. They were good, don't get me wrong. They were talented, don't get me wrong. The words of the songs were on point. And I heard them. But here's how I can tell you the difference between telling and selling. They were telling the story. Amen. I had heard this group three other times before that week. I was down in southern Illinois. This was a local group. And they were family members. And therefore, wherever they were going to sing, I went with them. I had already heard them twice that week. Nothing. Same program. I don't know if you know that or not, but most singing groups, when they come here, they do the same thing they did at church yesterday. And they sang the same songs, same key, Same piano, same drum set, same people sang the same songs. But the difference was the Holy Spirit was there talking specifically to me. They were doing the telling and He was doing the selling. Our job is to tell and His job is to sell. Amen? All right. Ooh, 2 minutes left. Let's go. Okay? The last point I want to make is this. That's unfair because it's probably not true. The Greek word for witness, you know what it is? It's going to hurt. The Greek word for witness is the same place we get our word martyr. And the word martyr means to give your life for a cause. To give your life for a cause. In our comfortable homes in America, we don't understand what persecution and martyrdom is. Other places on the planet, it's daily life. Who knows? Maybe coming to a town near you. So the Greek word is martyr. A witness is given their life for this cause. Amen? I've said this a lot, and I want to say it one more time, and then we'll close and we'll go home. All right? Nobody can tell your story correctly but you. Your story is your testimony. Your testimony is what witnesses do. They testify. They tell what they know. And they tell what they've experienced. I'll be honest with you. I wasn't there when Jesus was alive. I wasn't there when Jesus was crucified. I wasn't there when He was raised from the dead. I wasn't there when He was ascended. I wasn't there when His followers fanned out into the city of Jerusalem and began to do the works that He did. I wasn't there. I didn't see any of that. Therefore, I cannot witness to the fact that I have seen those things. I can only tell what I have seen and what I have heard. So how important is it that we have an authentic relationship with the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, that empowered us to do things? How important? I don't have a story to tell if I don't have Him. I've told you my story and you're bored. I told you about a little boy sitting on the back of the church and crying and sniffling, you know, when Pastor Arthur L. Irvin came and said, "Ricky, what's the matter, son?" "I don't know." "I know." He took me to the front of the church and introduced me to Jesus. "Wish I could have told you that everything's been sunny and roses and birds chirping and all those things since that day, but it surely has not." I've had ups and downs, ins and outs. I've been I've been ashamed of my progress, ashamed of my performance, until I found out it's not about your performance. It's about His grace. And sometime, if we have the time, I'll tell you all the gory details of my life. And maybe you'll tell me yours. But can I tell you something? We would be wasting our time. Because you're saved and so am I. Take that story and find somebody who has never met Jesus or have met Him at one time and walked away and say, and look Him in their eye and say, me too. And tell your story and let Him sell the rest. I believe He'll do it, don't you? How important is it that we have the Holy Spirit resident in our lives? Absolutely important. You cannot do it without Him. If you could, Jesus came in vain. He died in vain. You didn't need Him at all. You could have done it all by yourself, just by keeping the rules. But I'm no better at keeping the rules than you are. Therefore, I needed Him, and He knew it. Way back in the Old Testament, He knew I wouldn't be able to do it without Him. And therefore, He empowered us with the Holy Spirit to live for Him and to serve Him. Amen. We're going to stop there, and we're going to let the Holy Spirit do the rest of the work, and we're going to ask God to minister the words into our heart and the series into our heart. Amen. And plant it within our spirit so that we can use it in the days to come. All right. Stand with us together. Father, we thank You for Your goodness and grace and mercy, first of all, because none of us would be here without it. We're thankful for Your loving kindness and Your patience, because without it, we wouldn't be here either. We thank Thee, Lord, through the Holy Spirit, You have empowered us to do what it is You've called us to do. You didn't leave us here to do it ourselves. You empowered us to do it. You gave us a new heart with new desires, and You gave us Your Spirit that we would be able to do it. And therefore, I have no excuse. I have no excuse not to do it. Since You've done it all for me, I have no excuse not to do it. I have no excuse for not keeping Your statutes and Your judgments, because You said You would place the Holy Spirit inside my life and give me a new heart and new desires, and that would cause me to do it. I have no excuse. Father, I don't know what it's going to be like at the pearly gates if there's going to be an angel there with an open book, and I have no idea. Maybe the cartoons are right and maybe they're not. But I do believe with all of my heart that Your grace is sufficient to get me where I need to be right on time, with the tools I need to do what You've called me to do. I believe I'm doing some of that tonight. But God, don't ever let me pass by the little boy on the bridge again. If it's my job to ask somebody if they're all right and to tell them my story, don't let me pass them by. There's no plan B. Thankful for the ones that You put in my life that helped me. Now help me be that to somebody else. Help me live out the gospel message. Help me to be able to preach the truth according to the Word of God, but then be able to tell somebody what I've experienced and what I know to be the truth because I've seen it. I can tell you what God has done for my life, and I can tell you what He has done for my family, and I can tell you where He has been. And I need your Holy Spirit to be able to show me those things and empower us for life and service. We're thankful for your grace. Thank you for this series. And place this word in our heart, and plant it in us, and graft it in us that in the days to come we can use these things in our own personal life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Give the Lord a good hand clap of praise. I'm thankful for His goodness. Amen. God bless you. God bless you.